this is a wonderful occasion to bring together the military and the Coronado community, and we're so grateful to see all of you here today. This is quite a crowd. This is more than we had last time, and we're just delighted you're here. So I'm Tina Friend. I'm Coronado's city manager. And this is the second time I've been able to host this program. And I have to say, this is my favorite thing that we do. I think it is a magnificent event. I think it is a beautiful occasion to come together for this honoring. So it means so much to me to see all the faces out there today, and we're delighted you're here. So this program is predicated on recognizing the military in Coronado and the men and women who currently live here or have lived here across all the branches. I think it's a very unique program. You don't see this in other communities. And again, we're so honored you're here today. And for me especially, I personally have a special connection to the military. I grew up as an Army brat, and my grandfather was a Marine. And so I grew up with a strong military tradition. And so imagine my delight when I was able to land and work in a community that embraces the military so much. So it has personal resonance for me, and I do love the fact that we celebrate and embrace all the branches here today. So before we go any further, I do want to recognize some of our special guests that we have this morning. First, from the Coronado City Council, we have Mayor Richard Bailey back there. We have Council Member Mike Donovan here up front. We have Council Member Casey Tanaka. We also have several representatives from Naval Base Coronado and also from the Coronado Historical Association. So thank you so much for attending today. From the Silver Strand Chapter of the Military Officers Association of America, we have President Bob Braglio.
Bob.
From the Coronado Council of the Navy League, President Joyce Murphy. Joyce. Good morning. And I also have to point out that from the Coronado Fire Department, we are joined by our Fire Chief, Mike Blood. And our Fire Division Chief, Jason Summers. Thanks for joining us. And I want to note that this event being a beautiful confluence of community, military, and history, in recognition of the honoree's contributions to our history here in Coronado, the Coronado Historical Association graciously provides every honoree or their family a one-year membership. So thank you to the CHA.
Oh, see, does that star-spangled
incredibly talented Deanna Holla. Thank you so much. I had goosebumps. I don't know about you, I had goosebumps. And we also want to thank the Coronado High School Navy Junior ROTC for the presentation. Say, did you see coming down North Avenue this morning all of the flags that the Rotary placed up? Wasn't that magnificent? So that was a surprise to me. It was very moving as I came in this morning. So thank you to the Rotary for doing that. This is something every Memorial Day and every Veterans Day we see that. And what a gift for us this morning. Okay, so as we get moving to the program, I want to share a bit of history about how the Hometown Heroes Banner Celebration Program came about. So the City of Coronado introduced the Avenue of Heroes program in 2014, and so far has honored 206 hometown heroes, and today we'll honor another 11. The city is grateful to support and fund this program, and volunteers from the Veterans of Foreign Wars Post 2422, the Coronado Historical Association, the 3rd and 4th Streets Neighborhood Association, as well as city staff oversee its operation. So it's this beautiful blending together of the city, local VFW post, and motivated volunteers in the community. So at this time, I'd like to recognize some of the volunteers who made the program possible. So if you're here, if you could stand, and so we could recognize you. Lee Fulmer. And we have Jim Jameson. We have Vince Marchetti. Darlene Parker, right here, friends. And Dallas Stewart. Yeah. And so they really make the magic happen. Along with city staff, they've taken all of the ideas for honorees, they curate, they support the program. They're really the power behind making it happen, so we're very grateful to you. Thank you. And now I want to recognize the city staff who worked tirelessly. So I do hope you enjoy the reception afterwards and enjoy the decorations, because that was brought to you and all the organization by Kelly Purvis, Michelle Miller, Kelly Maples, and Janine Zuniga in my office. A wonderful partnership. A lot of time. They do tremendous work. We do this twice a year, so it's really an ongoing, consistent theme of work. So now for the inspiration. Why do we have the Avenue of Heroes? So the inspiration came one memorable day as two Navy SEALs were being moved to their final resting place. As people became aware that the procession would move through Coronado, the local Rotary Club handed out American flags, schools were dismissed, and members of the community lined 4th Street to pay their respects. Just beautiful. As the somber procession approached the San Diego Coronado Bridge, a lone Navy SEAL stood at attention, saluting as he waited for the passage of his comrades. At that moment, it was clear that 3rd and 4th Streets constituted our Avenue of Heroes. So out of that spontaneous community gathering to honor the fallen SEAL, the program was launched in May 2015, with the first class of 18 honorees, and now we're up to 206. Heroes have been recognized from all branches of the military. We've had Air Force, Army, Navy, and Marine Corps, and there have been many honorees, from Congressional Medal of Honor recipients James Doolittle, a military aviation pioneer, to Vice Admiral James B. Stockdale, you know, a really local icon here in Coronado, naval aviator and a 7-year prisoner of war, as well as many others who grew up or called Coronado home at some point in their lives. And as we get into their stories, you will see that everyone has such a rich array of experience, and everything is this beautiful story. So it is just magnificent, the level of service and the histories everyone has. So, and I would next like to call attention to the Coronado resident who advocated for the Hometown Heroes program. Ms. Tony McGowan became a proponent of honoring Coronado military members and encouraged the city to support it. And after, with her encouragement and after that spontaneous activity, the city designated State Route 282, and that's 3rd and 4th Streets, going up to the main gate of Naval Base Coronado. We called it our Avenue of Heroes, and granted McGowan's wish by adopting the Companion Banner Program. So McGowan passed away in early 2019, but she was able to see the program fully realized and the banners of local heroes installed along the Avenue of Heroes before she passed. So it really is wonderful, again, the grassroots and how this community, this program grew up. So the six foot tall hometown banners are installed on or about Veterans Day in November and Memorial Day in May. Here we are. And once retired, they are available to the honoree or their families. The honorees or family members also receive a keepsake miniature replica banner, which you'll see today, programs, and a lapel pin commemorating the ceremony. And again, today marks the 14th class of heroes. And we're about to get into the main event of the program, but before we begin, I'd like to take a moment to recognize the sponsors and biography writers, which are sometimes the same person, who help provide the words and images that are invaluable in helping to portray historic records and deeply human lives and memories their careers deserve. So for those of you who took the time to apply, to write, and supply the photographs that we're gonna see here, thank you so much. You're breathing life into this program, and we're honored that you're sharing these stories and sharing these memories with us. So a round of applause for those folks.
Our first honoree is Rear Admiral Stephen Scott Clary. Rear Admiral Stephen Clary was born in Honolulu in 1940. Born into a Navy family, the son of late Admiral Bernard A. Clary and Jean Scott Clary, he and his mother, who had lived in Coronado in the 1920s and 30s, arrived in Coronado in 1942, shortly after the attack on Pearl Harbor, where they spent the rest of the war. Clary attended Miss Bunny McKenzie's nursery school in Coronado, which she, in a congratulatory call many years later, credited to his becoming a Navy flag officer. Growing up, he led the life of a typical service junior, attending 13 schools, including Sacred Heart here in town and Coronado Middle School, before graduating from Punahou School in Honolulu and later Williams College and Harvard Business School. Clary joined the Navy 2 weeks after graduating from Williams and received his commission from Officer Candidate School in Newport, Rhode Island. His initial CDV was in destroyers, and he made 2 deployments to the Tonkin Gulf during the Vietnam War, while providing naval artillery support to the Marines and Army forces near the demilitarized zone. His ship came under intense and repeated fire from the North Vietnamese shore batteries. In addition to multiple tours in the Pentagon, the Navy Strategic Planning and Financial Management, Clary had 4 commands at sea. As a flag officer, he deployed twice to the Persian Gulf during the First Gulf War. He commanded the U.S. Maritime Prepositioning Force during Operation Desert Shield. Deploying from the West Coast again in December of 1990, he commanded the Pacific Fleet, 5th Marine Expeditionary Brigade Amphibious Task Force, 18 ships and more than 7,000 Marines. In February of 1991, those Marines were offloaded in northeast Saudi Arabia, where they joined in the coalition ground campaign in the liberation of Kuwait. Clary has been active in the community and civic affairs since retiring from the Navy. He was president of the San Diego USO and helped establish the permanent USO reception center at the San Diego International Airport. He is a long-standing member of the executive committee at the University of California, San Diego. OSHA Lifelong Learning Institute, and oversees the curriculum and marketing programs. Thank you for your service, Evan. The next biography is for Major General Alphonse Frenchy Decarre. Major General Alphonse Frenchy Decarre was born on November 15, 1892 in Washington, D.C. He entered the Marine Corps and was commissioned as second lieutenant, serial number 0-TAC-230, on his 21st birthday. In June 1915, Decarre joined 2nd Marine Regiment and sailed for Port-au-Prince, Haiti. There, he clashed with the Haitian rebels and was promoted to first lieutenant. He was decorated with the Haitian Medal of Honor and Haitian Distinguished Service Medal. At the start of World War I, Captain Decarre then transferred to the 5th Marine Regiment as commanding officer of headquarters company. Decarre arrived in France in July 1917 and went to the trenches of the Verdun sector from March to May of 1918. During the Battle of Belle Wood in June 1918, Captain Decarre commanded a small detachment in the rear attacking battalion. He continued forward after the advanced battalion had changed directions. Shortly, he encountered deadly machine gun fire, but pressed on, alone, capturing 2 guns. He then brought up his detachment of only six men and captured a machine gun company of 169 Germans. For his effort, Ikari was decorated with the Army Distinguished Service Cross and the Navy Cross. Subsequently, he participated in the Anmarin Offensive and the Battle of Chateau Thierry, the battalion, and the Battle of Soissons. He was then promoted to Major in September 1918 and was appointed to Operations and Intelligence Officer of 5th Marines. Ikari served in this capacity during the Battle of Blancmont Ridge and was again decorated with the Silver Star Citation for Gallantry in Action on October 9, 1918. In 1939, Colonel Ikari was commander of barracks at Puget Sound. In July of 1942, he was transferred to San Diego, promoted to Brigadier General, appointed Assistant Division Commander. General Ikari then acted as the commander of the 2nd Marine Division, leading the division in the Guadalcanal campaign. He commanded the division there until May 1943. Ikari then served at Camp Pendleton in Quantico. He retired in June 1946 as a major general. After retirement, he moved to Coronado with his wife Mildred and daughter Patricia. He passed away in 1977 and is buried at Fort Rosecrans. Thank you for your service, General. Will Major General Ikari's family please come forward? Shake the hand that shook the hand of Teddy Roosevelt is how we have always introduced himself. Born in Sioux Falls, South Dakota in 1895 into a Norwegian immigrant family, Hane Geeling met Teddy Roosevelt as a child while attending a campaign rally at the famous Corn Palace. He grew up on the shores of Lake Michigan in Manitowoc, Wisconsin. Geeling attended the University of Wisconsin for 1 year before transferring to the Naval Academy. He graduated early in March of 1917 to join U.S. forces fighting in World War I. He first served as a navigator before radar on one of the first oil-burning destroyers, USS Starrett, and he took the first U.S. Navy ship, the destroyer USS Elliott, up the Yangtze River in China in 1920. Between world wars, Geeling studied ordnance engineering at the Naval Postgraduate School and earned a master's degree at Columbia University. During the Battle of Guadalcanal in 1942, Geeling was awarded the Navy Cross, the service's highest decoration for valor after the Medal of Honor, as commanding officer of troop transport ship USS Crescent City. The citation reads, Captain Geeling maneuvered his unit with such outstanding courage and tactical ability that he not only fought his forces through without damage, but successfully repelled the enemy attack. Crescent City shot down 5 Japanese torpedo planes that night. As a rear admiral, Geeling and his amphibious task group took the Japanese-held island of Kamaretta, routing out the suicide boat caves scattered on the island and ensuring it could be used to support the ensuing assault on Okinawa. During the Korean War, Geeling was commander of all amphibious forces of the Pacific Fleet. After his final tour as the commandant of the 5th Naval District in Norfolk, Virginia, he retired in 1957 as a vice admiral. He and his wife Isabel retired to their home in Coronado, where they lived until his death in 1992. He had one son, retired captain, 2 grandchildren, one of whom also served in the Navy, and 4 great-grandchildren. Thank you for your service, Admiral. So, Vice Admiral, please. Reverend Dr. Deborah Mariah was born in Long Beach, California, and grew up in Laverne, Minnesota. She graduated from Augustana University and Garrett Evangelical Theological Seminary in Evanston, Illinois. She was ordained in the United Methodist Church Iowa Annual Conference in 1983 and served as pastor to 6 churches through those years. In 1988, Reverend Mariah joined the U.S. Naval Reserves. She answered a call to active duty in early 1990. Chaplain Mariah was assigned as the command chaplain of the USS Cape Cod with a crew of 1,200, 400 of whom were women. The ship deployed to Operation Desert Storm and provided repair services in the Persian Gulf's heavily mined waters. Following the war, Cape Cod provided disaster relief in the Philippines during the eruption of Mount Pinatubo. Chaplain Mariah ran the emergency programs to rescue children from collapsed buildings, providing emergency relief for displaced Americans, and assisted in the evacuation of service members. After a second deployment to the Middle East, Chaplain Mariah was assigned to National Naval Medical Center in Bethesda, Maryland, where she worked with National Institutes of Health Cancer Programs and patients. And she also conducted Protestant services there. And she was the chaplain. She was also the chaplain of the hospital ship USNS Comfort, deploying to Haiti as part of Operation Uphold Democracy. She returned to San Diego, where she served as a squadron chaplain aboard USS Texas, as women were being first assigned to that ship. She was assigned as a command chaplain of command chaplain assistant team. In the days before email, this was a critical communication avenue. Her last duty station was the Naval Security Station in Washington, D.C. She served as command chaplain and chaplain pastor. She led burial services at Arlington National Cemetery and had the great honor of providing the blessing for a new portion of the Holocaust Museum. Following her naval service, Reverend Mariah completed her Doctor of Ministry degree at Wesley Theological Seminary in Washington, D.C., while serving as a pastor of the United Methodist Church in Chickamauga, Maryland. She is the mother of Mercy, a 2021 graduate of Coronado High and a current freshman at the University of Hawaii, Honolulu. Thank you for your service, Commander. Will Chaplain Mariah's family please come forward? U.S. Marine Staff Sergeant James Charles Moore was born January 29, 1930, in Swissvale, Pennsylvania. Moore had a twin brother, also a Marine, and three other siblings. During World War II, two Marines from Swissvale visited his high school. He was impressed with their stories, foreign travel, and opportunity to learn a trade as an aircraft and engine mechanic. They enlisted in February of 1949 in Pittsburgh. After graduating from boot camp at Parris Island, South Carolina, Moore was ordered to Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, and assigned the 2nd Medical Battalion. Training complete, he was ordered to Rodman Naval Station near Panama for a two-year tour and trained as a military policeman. In June 1950, the Korean War started, and he wanted to volunteer immediately, but because of his orders to Panama until September 1951, he could not. After leaving Panama, he sailed to New York, sailed right past the Statue of Liberty into Brooklyn Naval Yard. Orders ensued to Camp Pendleton, California for 3 months of combat training. He then left for Korea, assigned to Dog Company, 2nd Battalion, 7th Marines, 1st Marine Division as an infantryman. Dog Company was based in the Haebaek Mountains of North Korea. On Memorial Day 1952, Dog Company led an attack. Halfway up, intense small arms gunfire erupted, and grenades were rolling down. One landed 4 feet from Moore, who was wounded on his left side. He was taken to the Marshfield Hospital and transferred to the USS Constellation Hospital ship. There, he was awarded a Purple Heart. He was then transferred to Yokosuka, Japan for many more operations and further recovery. He was then sent home. Additional awards include the Combat Action Ribbon, American Defense Service Ribbon or Medal, Korea Defense Medal, Navy and Marine Corps Commendation Medal for Valor, and the Good Conduct Medal. He was honorably discharged October 8, 1952. Moore settled in Coronado. He entered the apprenticeship at Naval Air Station North Island and became an aircraft mechanic. He retired from civil service after 37 years as an industrial engineering technician. He and his wife Carol still live in Coronado. They have 4 children and 5 grandchildren. Thank you for your service, Staff Sergeant. For the family of Staff Sergeant James Charles Moore, please come forward.
next biography is for Commander Mary Jane Osmania Perry. Mary Jane M.J. Osmania Perry was born into a Native family on September 30th, 1967, in Great Lakes, Illinois. She grew up in Portsmouth, Rhode Island, and was always too humble to talk about the beauty pageants she won. She graduated from College of the Holy Cross Naval ROTC Unit in 1989, and then began her career in the United States Navy. Perry served her country for 20 years as a naval officer, first hunting Soviet submarines, and later providing invaluable human resource support to thousands of Navy service members and their families while stationed in Okinawa, Hawaii, California, and Washington, D.C. It was in the Navy she met and married her husband, Captain Ryan Perry. In 2015, they made Coronado their home, and the family still lives here. After her retirement, Perry continued to be an exceptional leader and mentor in Coronado. She was a golf enthusiast, community caretaker, and all-around unstoppable woman. Perry spent her time mentoring fellow female naval officers between tee times at Naval Base Coronado Sea and Air Golf Club. And she never missed an island of football, basketball, or baseball game. Perry passed away on April 6, 2021, at the age of 53. She's survived by her children, Lieutenant Blake McRae, Raiden Perry, and Malia Perry. Her parents, Divino Leticia Osmania of Portsmouth, sister Divina Bradshaw of Naples, Florida, and many other family members and friends at home and abroad. Her widower, Captain Perry, is an active duty Navy captain and is stationed here at Naval Special Warfare. At her funeral, several islands were filled with Coronado High School Islander baseball players who wore their jerseys to honor her and pay their respects. Members of both the local and naval communities remembered MJ as devoted, protected, and altruistic. Perry's daughter is a freshman at Coronado High School. Her oldest son is a helicopter pilot at Naval Air Station North Island. Her second son played several varsity sports at CHS during his 4 years. Her husband is stationed at Naval Special Warfare Command, and he is honored that MJ will smile down on the sailors and officers as they drive to Naval Station North Island every day, and that the banner will serve as a reminder of her service. Thank you for your service, Commander. Is for Vice Admiral Philip Quast. Vice Admiral Philip Quast is a 36-year Navy surface warfare veteran and the son, brother, and father of naval officers. Having served two tours in Vietnam, as well as leading the Nimitz battle group during Operation Desert Storm, Quast has distinguished himself as the Pacific Fleet's first recipient of the Vice Admiral James Bond Stockdale Leadership Award, which recognizes leadership proficiency in command at sea. After graduating from Carroll College in Waukesha, Wisconsin, Quast served in a variety of seagoing assignments, including navigator aboard USS King, weapons officer aboard USS Queen, commander Naval River Patrol Division 532 in Vietnam, and executive officer of USS Talbot. He was a commanding officer of USS Benjamin Stoddard and a commissioning commanding officer of USS Bunker Hill. While on the Bunker Hill's initial Western Pacific deployment, he served as commander of the Battleship Missouri Battle Group and supported Operation Earnest Will, the escort of U.S. flagged tankers transiting through the Strait of Hormuz. During Desert Storm, he commanded the Nimitz Battle Group, Cruiser Destroyer Group 3. Vice Admiral Quast's shore assignments included instructor at the California Maritime Academy, personnel program officer of the Commander, Cruiser Destroyer Force, U.S. Atlantic Fleet, instructor of weapons systems engineering, and battalion officer for the Brigade of Midshipmen at the U.S. Naval Academy, and junior assignment branch head, Bureau of Personnel. Vice Admiral Quast's flag assignments included head, assignment division, Naval Military Personnel Command, and staff of the Chief of Naval operations as Director, Total Force Management Programming Division, and as Director, Military Personnel Policy Division. He also served as Director, Surface Warfare Division, Chief of Naval Personnel Staff. His final assignment was as Head of the Military Sealift Command. Vice Admiral Quast's personal decorations include the Legion of Merit with 4 gold stars in lieu of subsequent awards, the Bronze Star with Combat V and 1 gold star, Meritorious Service Medal, and Navy Commendation Medal. Vice Admiral Quast was married to the former Peggy Lord of Santa Barbara, California, and they have a family of 5 children and 12 grandchildren. Thank you for your service, Admiral. This next biography is for Captain Edward Bryan Rogers, Jr. Captain Edward Bryan Rogers, Jr., U.S. Navy retired, was a graduate of Coronado High School class 1943, where he was captain of the football team and student council president. He received his Navy commission with U.S. Naval Academy class of 1948. His first naval duty assignment was to USS Norris until receiving orders to submarine school in 1951. He then served on USS Aspro and USS Spinax in San Diego. In 1953, while serving on Spinax, he met and married the love of his life, Gail Wesker, a teacher in Coronado. After this time on Spinax, Rogers attended Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California, and served on USS Queenfish as Operations Specialist and then Executive Officer. He also taught at Submarine School in Groton, Connecticut, attended the Naval War College in Newport, Rhode Island, and served as a commanding officer of USS Catfish until 1964. After a tour on the Chief of Naval Operations Submarine Operations Staff in 1966, he was transferred to Yokosuka, Japan as Operations Officer of the COM Subflot 7 Staff. He was subsequently assigned as Division Commander of COM Sub Division 72, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, in 1968. He returned to San Diego as commanding officer of USS Estes, then USS Assumpsic, and in 1972, following German language and attaché training, he assumed the duties of U.S. Naval Attaché to West Germany. In 1976, Captain Rogers returned to Washington, D.C. for his final naval tour as a Naval NASC program manager responsible for the Mark 48 torpedo development. He retired in June 1977 after 30 years of service in the U.S. Navy. Following retirement, Captain Rogers developed real estate in Virginia that included designing and building his own home. In 1987, Captain Rogers and his wife moved back to Coronado to live in what had been his parents' home on First Street. Not content to sit idle, he promptly added a second story and expanded the kitchen and family. Captain Rogers died in his home in Coronado in October 2021 at the age of 86. Thank you for your service, Captain. This next biography is for Chief Warrant Officer Richard Williams. Chief Warrant Officer Richard Williams was born on November 13th, 1935 in Perry Point, Maryland. The oldest of 6 siblings, he started his working career as a paperboy. In 1945, while hawking The War Ends headline newspaper for 3 cents, he was excited to get a nickel. Richard Williams' unique experience combines 44 years of service to the military for both the Army and the Navy. He was drafted in 1958 and reported to the 714th Transportation Battalion, railroad operating steam and diesel electric at Fort Eustis, Virginia. When the battalion adjutant asked Williams to volunteer to be a clerk, he declined, saying he wanted to work on the railroad instead. He was immediately assigned to the railroad maintenance crew gang carrying railroad ties. A few weeks later, Williams reconsidered and became the battalion clerk. In 1960, Williams transferred to the Army Reserve, 717th Transportation Battalion, railroad operating in Philadelphia, and became a dual-status administrative supply technician. Steadily promoted, Sergeant First Class Williams transferred to the headquarters 79th Army Reserve Command. Promoted to warrant officer in 1969, he started college and graduated in 1972. As a recent college graduate, Williams became a criminal investigator with the IRS, serving on the team that investigated Spiro Agnew's fraud. His Army Reserve Center continued with the Data Processing Unit and the 55th Material Management Command. In 1980, Chief Warrant Officer 3, Williams, retired from the Army. Moving to Washington, D.C., Williams worked for the Department of Labor and then Navy Facilities Engineering Command, Inspector General's Office. He spent 19 years at NAFAC, serving as Deputy Inspector General from 1988 to 2007, receiving the Navy Superior Civilian Service Medal. An avid runner for 45 years, Williams and his wife Kim met at a road race and moved to the Silver Strand in 2007. Williams has supported his community as a docent for the Coronado Historical Association, an officer in Silver Strand Chapter of the Military Officers Association of America, and inspires the community by regularly running road races, often placing first in his age group. Williams runs Coronado streets daily, reminding us that personal fitness is important at any age. Thank you for your service, Warrant Officer. This next biography is for Lieutenant Commander David Wood. Born in Tucson, Arizona, 1930, Lieutenant Commander David Wood, U.S. Navy, grew up on a farm in the Willamette Valley of Oregon. Graduating from Oregon State University, he was commissioned an ensign in the Navy and married Leona Van Hine on the same day, June 7, 1954. David earned his Wings of Gold the next year at Corpus Christi, Texas, and reported as a naval aviator to his first duty station, VC-11, Early Warning Squadron 11, at Naval Air Station North Island, Coronado. Flying the 85 Douglas attack aircraft, he deployed aboard USS Shangri-La before transferring to Miramar Naval Air Station and flying with VA-115. Other assignments included being a flight instructor in Pensacola and Jacksonville, Florida, deployment aboard USS Yorktown, an anti-submarine aircraft carrier, and deployment aboard USS Arisbe. During the Vietnam War, Wood flew the Sky Raider early warning aircraft, nicknamed the Guppy, with his navigator, Wayne McCarver. Wood was stationed at Naval Air Station Lemoore from 1967 to 69 and served as an instructor in the Navy's newest attack aircraft at the time, the A-4 Skyhawk. Wood and his wife moved to Coronado in 1969, raised 3 daughters, and still reside here today. His final naval assignments included Air Control Squadron 13, where he was responsible for aerial bombing and gunfire spotting, and Phaser Trade Group, where he provided flight simulation training to the fleet. By his retirement in 1974, Commander Wood had completed 20 years of service and 5 WestPAC deployments. Returning to his agricultural roots, Wood went to work in the San Joaquin Valley as a supervisor in the almond and walnut industry. He subsequently managed the Crown Hotel coffee shop, owned Coronado's XL Travel Agency, and was a 20-year member of Kiwanis, serving as its president in 82 to 83. Wood has sung in the St. Paul United Methodist Church Choir for more than 38 years. Most mornings, you will find him walking on the beach and later visiting with friends at the VFW or at the Senior Center. He enjoys trips in his motorhome and snow skiing with the 70s Club. Thank you for your service, Commander. Final biography today is for Rear Admiral George Rhodes Worthington. Born in Louisville, Kentucky in 1937, Rear Admiral George Rhodes Worthington grew up in Tucson, Arizona, attended South Kent School in Connecticut, and spent 1 year at Brown University before matriculating to the United States Naval Academy. A member of Second Company, he graduated and was commissioned ensign in 1961. His first tour was aboard USS Halsey Powell, which participated in the 1962 Christmas Island bomb test. Following a two-year assignment as Flag 8 with Cruiser Destroyer Flotilla 7, Worthington volunteered for underwater demolition team training in Coronado. He graduated with a class of 36 and deployed in support of 7th Fleet operations. Rising through the ranks, he would command SEAL Team 1, Inshore Undersea Warfare Group 1, Naval Special Warfare Group 1, and Naval Special Warfare Command. He also completed staff tours with Naval Special Warfare Group in Vietnam, as Naval Attaché to U.S. Embassy in Cambodia, and on the staffs of both the Chief of Naval Operations and the First Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations and Low Intensity Conflict. A graduate of both U.S. Marine Corps Command and Staff and National War Colleges, he retired from active duty in 1992. George was a member of the San Diego Military Advisory Council and served on several boards, including Zodiac North America, L3 Communications, West Camp Sonoma, and Special Warrior Foundation, a nonprofit organization providing college scholarships for children of deceased members of Special Operations Forces. He worked on littoral warfare requirements and initiated the Navy's Sea Fighter Project. Worthington penned chapters about the SEAL teams for two anthologies, the Navy and United States Special Operations Forces, and he co-authored the book Naval Special Warfare. His memoir, Running with Frogs, was published in 2018. Along with being a U.S. Parachute Association D-licensed sport parachutist with 1,622 skydives, he was an avid skier and U.S. Master Swimming All-American. George is survived by his wife, Veronica, children, Rose, Graham, Greer, 5 grandchildren, Madeline, Kenzie, George, Penelope, and Reed, brother, William, and former wife, Sydney Alexander Worthington, mother of his children. Admiral Worthington died from complications of Parkinson's at home on December 18, 2000. 21. Thank you for your service, Admiral.
We would now like to recognize all current and former honorees and their sponsors. Please stand. Thank you to all our honorees, their family and friends, the City of Coronado for its sponsorship of this event, and for all of those who put this together. As we approach Memorial Day, we are honored to tell the stories of these local heroes and to show our appreciation for all they do and have done for our country and our community. Please consider attending Coronado's Memorial Day service at Star Park on the 30th. Now I will ask Coronado City Manager Tina Friend back to the stage for her closing remarks.
Those stories are wonderful, absolutely wonderful. Wow, I'm listening to the stories, and I think the moments my eyes were tearing up, I was laughing, and really just in my heart, I'm just so humbled by the stories and the service, and how much these men and women have given to our country and to all of us. So, oh, just astounding. And I will say that although many of our honorees today, they reach back in time, they're contemporary, some have Bronze Stars, Purple Hearts, believe there's heroes in all aspects of our military. So we do encourage you to, we do this program twice a year. We love honoring our military, so please do apply. Nominate some of your colleagues or some people in your families and your history, because we want to keep up this tradition of honoring all of us who give so deeply back to our community. We are so grateful for your service. So nominations are accepted year-round, and we have a brochure out in the lobby. And that is it. So we're going to run the slideshow presentation another time. If you want to see the slides again, and there's if you missed some of the pictures, please do that. So again, I want to thank our dignitaries for being here. I want to thank our volunteers on the Hometown Banner Committee and the Coronado Historical Association. I want to thank Jim and Daniel for their wonderful readings of the biographies today. Yeah. So much. Oh, we're so grateful and so honored. And thank you to the families, the adopted families, the friends that came here today to celebrate us. Thanks to the Islanders baseball team up there for being great ushers. And with that, we're going to close for the day. Please enjoy the refreshments on your way out. Thank you so much, and enjoy your day here in Coronado. Thank you.